Once in a while, you come across a song where you think one of two things. Either A, wow, I wish I wrote that. Or B, this is totally about me. And I can say that this song is one of those things for me. Let's rewind to the summer of 2005. I was 15, about to turn 16 very shortly, and the person I was with at the time had a birthday before me, and then she received a bunch of gifts. Among various music things that she did receive, two things that definitely stood out were a copy of the Nine Inch Nails live DVD and All That Could Have Been, released in 2002, and a copy of their most recent album at that point, With Teeth, that had just come out in May of that year. At that point, maybe I've heard a Nine Inch Nails song or two, but nothing that I was really paying attention to that all that much at the time. But when we sat down to watch that live DVD, it was definitely a life-changing moment, musically speaking at the very least. Though I had listened to acts with varying degrees of metal and rock with those strong industrial tones, such as Mushroomhead, Static X, Skinny Puppy, and Rammstein, Nine Inch Nails just hit me differently. There was a raw and aggressive energy to everything while still feeling very approachable and enduring. So by the time that we sat down and listened to the With Teeth album, all bets were off. Despite it being a far more guitar-driven album than their previous works, it still held some intense industrial passages while also playing some very well-thought-out melodic work. Things were catchy, but it still had some teeth to it. No pun intended. From absolute power hitters such as You Know What You Are, to catchy anthemic numbers like The Hand That Feeds, to quieter atmospheric tracks like Right Where It Belongs. Right where it belongs. What if every... It feels like there were touches of everything all over the album. Though, one song that I did initially like, it wouldn't be until years later until I realized just how much it resonated with me. From my late teens into my mid to late 20s, without going into too much detail, I was going through some pretty personal and dark, troublesome times. Within that frame of time, this one song just tended to stick to me like glue. And lyrically, as campy as it might sound, it sounds like something that could have come directly from my own mind and pen. It's definitely one of those cheesy and cliche, this song was written for me type situations. That song was, and is, The Line Begins to Blur. The Line Begins to Blur is the 11th out of 13 songs off of Nine Inch Nails' fourth full-length album, 2005's With Teeth. The album originally began life under the name Bleed Through, with an early rendition of the art style we would know the album to have today. The album was released through Nothing Records, a subsidiary of Interscope Records that was owned by Trent Reznor and John Malm Jr. The album was recorded at a few different studios between September and December 2004. The locations included a few out of Los Angeles, including Grandmaster Recorders, Sound City, and The Village. And as well as being the final full project recorded out of the now defunct Nothing Studios based out of New Orleans, Louisiana. The project was produced by Reznor and longtime production collaborators Alan Mulder and Atticus Ross, the latter of which would become a full-time member of Nine Inch Nails in the mid-2010s. The song itself was written and performed by Reznor, with the addition of Foo Fighters frontman Dave Grohl on live drums and percussion for this and many other tracks across the entire album. This song follows a streamline of themes that the entire album represents, that being personal struggles and anxieties about the world as a whole and exactly where you might fit into it. It should also be noted that this is the first Nine Inch Nails album that was done while Trent was sober after years of battling a drug and alcohol addiction. As The Guardian reported back in 2013, following a failed rehab attempt while touring his soundscape epic The Fragile in 2000, Reznor overdosed in London on China White heroin that he had mistaken for cocaine. The Line Begins to Blur is no different in that matter. The biggest emotional factors driving this song are depression, anxiety, and dissociation. The first verse seems to be a reflection on his own personal struggles, likely involving his addictions. Feeling too far gone paired with the self-loathing of that time frame. The second verse plays more into the anxieties of how he feels about it all. The fear and uncertainty of how he got to that place, and if it really truly ever has an end. And dealing with the choruses, we see the effect that a full-blown depression has on him. Realizing you're a lot worse off than you imagined, and that you're essentially too far gone to be fixed. It's as if he simply accepted fate at this point. He spent years watching himself fall apart, and then he just lost the ability to care about fixing it. Now, I had mentioned earlier that the lyrics of this song resonated with me strongly about things that have happened in my own past. I went through many difficult bouts of depression, anxiety, self-loathing, lack of self-confidence and even a close call or two with alcoholism. There was almost no avenues in my entire life that I had turned to and felt positive about in the end. Even the things that I found that I was good at or things I got recognition for, I still felt this immense sense of imposter syndrome about it all. Now, despite what I could say about my own experiences through my own sets of lyrics, I think The Line Begins to Blur is a perfect representation of how I felt at this point in time in my life. And that's honestly kind of the beautiful thing about these types of lyrics. Even the bleak nature and the tragic nature behind the meaning of everything, you can find this relatability and almost this kinship that can really help take away that isolating feeling that this whole emotional state can create. There's no real intricate melodies in this song, especially in the verses. The vocals are definitely the exception to the rule, with these long, drawn-out, yelled portions over top of this very pounding one-note march. The bass has a dry, rumbling distortion to it, and that's riding on top of a very percussion-heavy drum groove performed with ease by Dave Grohl. For what it lacks in a melodic sense, though, it does make up for in its intensity. There's a dull layer of distortion and reverb on almost everything being presented, creating a harsh but enveloping atmosphere. This changes to a far more accessible and inviting atmosphere in the choruses, where there's still intensity to be found, but in a far more digestible way. Trent also pulls back on the vocals from the desperate style of yelling and wailing to a lower and calmer singing style. Despite the cold nature of the lyrics, the music feels at its most smooth and rich feeling here, especially moving into the final chorus and coda, where additional layers are added throughout the foreground and background. It creates an almost floating and drifting scenery that really makes the song feel far more expansive and grand. Aside from the bass, the vocals are the real driving force behind this track, and every instrumental passage pairs with and accents perfectly to every single vocal line. The pounding nature of the verses do so much for the emotion of the vocal presentation, where the chorus allows them to smoothen out in a more grounded position. At the point of me releasing this video, Nine Inch Nails has been my favorite band for 19 years and counting. It seems like everyone has that one band that they can have an emotional connection to, and I think Nails is definitely that band for me. Now granted, there are many songs within this catalog that I can emotionally attach myself to, but again, with everything I've said, this one just hit all the right notes at all the right times in my life. Even if I'm not in that same dark place I was when I grew to adore the song, I still listen to this song very fondly with a full heart. Even if the connection was made through very unfortunate mental and emotional circumstances, again, not to sound cliche or cheesy, but this is just my own personal reminder that I'm not alone in any of this, and neither are you, and we can always find something that truly helps, even in the places we least expect. And that's why I love this song.